joined now by the president of the Trail Blazers, Chris McGowan. Chris, thanks for stopping by. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
Things slowed down a little bit, a touch now?
Never slowed.
Well, I mean, just the emotion.
If I had a dollar for everyone to ask me,
I know everybody asks me too.
It's over. What do you do? You'd be a rich man. So actually, it actually gets busier for us.
You have
a couple of days to slow down and let everyone decompress, and then you're just right back at it. You know, thinking about next season and you know all the great stuff that we can try to put together.
Now, with all the busyness, I know you've had time to see the LA Kings. I mean, you know, they're ready to go against the Rangers.
They're playing unbelievable. They look very similar to how they looked when we won the Cup my last year being there, but I do think they have a little bit higher end talent. They have some better scorers, and they look very, very dangerous. That's not a fun team to play against, and, you know, if I had to predict, it looks like they're going to win another Cup this year.
Oh, the Rangers. The Rangers can't be. I remember at the start of the year.
Still got to play the games.
You still got to play the games.
So you and I talked earlier in the season about, as the playoffs were approaching, about, you know, you've been through a championship run with a team like that before. And we talked about how this town kind of goes to another level when the playoffs start. And it was a tremendous run, getting out of the first round and, of course, the game six shot and all of that. How was it for you, though, experiencing that and seeing what the town becomes and the true Blazermania hit like it did?
It was amazing, and it happens way sooner here than it would happen in most markets. Usually the second round or third round is when you see the pandemonium that you saw here, and we saw unbelievable fan support right away. And it really hit me, you know, after the shot and going out onto the Rose Quarter, and you see the fans to the stage, and we're dancing with the DJ, and you're just like, oh, my gosh.
This was great what you guys did. I mean, the glow sticks and the projection stuff. When that stuff comes together as a plan, does it, would you actually see it carried out? Were you as thrilled with it as maybe when you guys were planning this?
Yeah, this was really, we were really happy. Our job is to set the stage and get the energy level up so the players can come out and have, you know, the fans and going nuts. And, you know, our fans do that on a consistent basis. But you don't know what this is going to look like when you have 20,000 people doing it, how it's all going to work together. And set a really good stage for all of our games. And I had lots and lots of comments from people that were in Portland that experienced it, but also people that were all over the country watching it on TV and just talking and commenting on how interesting it looked. And, you know, we were really happy with it.
How did it affect season ticket holders? Was it a positive experience?
Yeah, I would think so. I mean, I haven't received any negative feedback, so I take that as a positive. And, you know, a lot of people didn't really know what to expect when you tell them you're going to give them a lighted glow stick. But when they see it, when they get in there and they see the lights go down, and, you know, we got a lot of feedback on the big projection screens as well. I mean, that was a lot of fun, and I don't think a lot of people have ever seen anything like that. So for us, our marketing group, our game presentation group is always trying to push the envelope a little bit and create something that maybe you won't see at other arenas throughout, whether it's hockey or NBA.
Now, last Saturday night, we were at a charity event, and Dr. William Johnson was there with his wife from Moda Health, and got to chat, talk to him about what a great season it's been and what a great time to come aboard. You know, I mean, it was only last summer we're talking about an arena, a new name. And
without a name.
Right, and you know, but what a home run. And for them, not only to have that for the first year, but what he talked about was, what a great marriage it's been for them. I mean, it's been just phenomenal. And for the Blazers, too. But what a stage for them to go through the playoffs and getting the recognition and the repeated mentions of the arena, which is what you pay for, let's be honest.
Yeah, I mean, they've been certainly happy with the first year. We've been really happy with it as well. You know, with the partnership, we talk to people about this a lot. Is when you're doing a long-term partnership, you want to make sure you have a great working relationship amongst the two groups, and we certainly have that. We meet regularly. I mean, Dr. Johnson has been there at games all the time. So it gives us a chance to catch up and talk about initiatives that we can maybe launch in the future. And year one is, you know, past us now, and it's all about what we can build on in year two. And, we've already been in the meeting rooms with their group, our group, and we're going to create a lot of special things. So we have a lot of things geared around community, geared around active lifestyle. And that's one of the reasons why we did the partnership. I'm sure, you know, the naming rights is a big part of it as well, but we want to develop a bunch of initiatives. You know, this is the community that we play in, and, you know, healthy living, which is very important to both organizations.
The restaurant situation with Levy, how is that progressing? I hear we're going to have all kinds of different things coming up next year. Is it going to be exciting?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, we've had a good first year with them. There was a little bit of a transition at the beginning, but bringing in lots of the local restaurants, we've talked a lot about that, and that's been really successful. successful, and we're going to continue to do that when it makes sense. Right now, we're revamping our entire club level, and we're bringing in 5 or 6 really amazing food concepts for up there that are a little bit different than what's in the rest of the arena. So we're excited to get to work on that and launch and unveil that with the start of next season. So they've been great partners as well, and they come to us with a lot of different perspectives, and they work with so many different teams and arenas out throughout the country that they can bring us concepts really quickly, and we can decide, you know, whether or not it'll work in Portland or not. But certainly the local flavor has been a huge hit, and, you know, something that our fans asked for, and, you know, we were happy that we were able to deliver that to them.
Rip City has always been a, you know, it's a strong appeal and value in this market, going all the way back. But nobody ever really capitalized on it like you guys did this last year. We saw Rip City become even more of a, not a motto, but almost a team name than we had seen in the past. And talk about your decision to do that, and the decision of many to do that, and then the fan reaction to it, because it seems like it's been really positive. Not just the Rip City jerseys, which people obviously love,
right,
but everything. And we saw the starting lineups here. I mean, the first thing you guys led with was Rip City, and so much of that. Why did you guys decide to do that?
Well, it's not something we're overly trying to capitalize on. We're just, you know, our fans have asked for that, and they react to it in a very positive manner. There's a sense of pride around Rip City, and, you know, statewide, really. And that's why we did it, is, you know, our fans are asking for it. So, you know, it's what we're all about. It's kind of put us on the map, you know, nationally, and people talk about Rip City no matter where you're at. So since it's such an authentic name and something that our fans gravitate towards, it's really easy for us just to make sure we're putting it out there in an appropriate manner, and certainly the feedback has been great. You know, our fans feel like they're part of Rip City, and that they make Rip City special. So, you know, as an organization, it's on us to just put it out there in front of them as much as we can.
You know, there's one spot that has been really successful. It's where Dr. Jack's is right now. It seems that's really catching on. I didn't know how that would be, but I talked to fans that they'd like to see it open year-round. They said, we'll come to Dr. Jack's. Has it been that successful?
Yeah, it really has. And, you know, it's not something that we're going to open year-round. That's been something that has been tried, and it didn't But it's been really, really additive and successful on event nights. So for Trailblazers before and after, for Winter Hawks before and after, for Thunder before and after, and all the concerts that we're bringing into the Rose Quarter, it's just been a great thing that adds to the fans' experience, where it's more convenient. They can come down a little bit early, go to a great restaurant space, have a great time, and then go to an event, and then come afterwards and celebrate that event as well. So it just works. It definitely works on event nights. It's not something that, you know, we're looking to open up 365, but who knows, in the future, you know, if things change a little bit, we can always look at it.
In the Houston playoff series, Mike and I were down in the court, and you get to know all the other broadcasters, and we certainly know that. We were talking to the Houston guys, and they were saying, man, we got a 3.5 rating in Houston last night. And you know, most markets, that's great. And I mentioned, well, we had a 25. and not we, but you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And it sounds self-serving when we bring it up. But you talk about the ratings in the playoffs, and we already mentioned how the town comes alive, but I would imagine for sponsors and for people who are involved with all of this, that's tremendous to show. It's a great thing to show the impact and to show the excitement and to show the fan involvement when you can post numbers like that in the playoffs. And regular season too, but playoffs were amazing.
Yeah, we have great regular season numbers as well. The playoffs were, I think it just speaks to how quickly it ramps up. To do that right away is just amazing. And then, like you said, you talk to people in most markets, there isn't that passion that we have here, and we're grateful for that, and that's what makes us work hard every day, because we know there's an extreme passionate fan base out there that's going to support our organization. And guess what? They support us during playoffs. I mean, that's kind of a no-brainer, but they support us when we were 0-13 to finish the season two seasons ago, and they were still coming to the building, still watching our games. And that's a real differentiator, and it's something that, it was one of the reasons why I wanted to come here, because you know you have that out there, and it's we're very grateful for it.
Any other changes we should know about, other than the who's going to broadcast the games or anything like that?
No, it's we had a season of change the last year and a half, so I'm happy to announce that we're probably going to see less changes. It's just about improving going forward and operating kind of off of some of the changes that we made in the last year and a half. just looking forward to the summer concert season. We got a lot of.
How do you get all those concerts? I see all the names I never saw before coming in.
Well, you go out and sell yourself, and you sell the city. It's a great music market. You get aggressive in promoting a great building. You have a great partner in Moda who enables you to invest back into the facility. And when acts and big artists want to go into arenas, they want to make sure it's a first-class arena. So it's a combination of many. You have a great marketing department, great promotion department. I have some good relationships in the concert world that's been helpful. And you just got to go out and talk to people about Portland. And it becomes a no-brainer because it's such a great music market and such a great venue to play in.
Did you see how he worked in the question about his own deal? And
I thought he was going to ask me for share tickets.
No, I'm shooting for James Taylor.
Not going to happen. You know, when we talk about the players and we talk about the team and all of this, how great is it to have a group of guys to sell like the Blazers have? I mean, you know, this fan in this town, and I'll tell you, has been through some great times and some not-so-great times when it comes to the personalities you sell and the type of people you're selling. And clearly there's an emphasis on bringing in great guys, guys you can be proud of and prop up in this group. I mean, we've been around a long time. I don't know of another one that has as many guys on it that you want to celebrate.
J.R. Ryder.
as this team.
Well, you have a combination of a lot of great things. You have amazing talent, LaMarcus Aldridge, and you have Damian Lillard, and you have a great starting five. But I think what's great about our team is it's truly a team. I mean, you can market everyone, and they play hard, and they're good guys, and they love the community, and they work hard. And to me, that resonates well in Oregon and Portland in particular. But, you know, that team concept is something that's pretty easy to market, and certainly our fans have reacted very well to it.
And a great coach leading him who was extended, and, you know, I mean, it was a great timing, as we talked about before. Some teams wait, but it was a statement a little bit when Terry Stotts got the extension. And he's got a guy that – the kind of guy that brought a lot of this stuff together, and players all spoke on his behalf all year and loved him. So great to have leadership, you know, is going to be their stability, as we talked about.
Yeah, between him and Neil, they both are obviously running the basketball side of things great. And I've had it's been a pleasure watching Terry coach. I get to sit and watch that, you know, on a nightly basis. And I mean, it's like he's having fun. It looks like players really enjoy playing for him. And, you know, it's a former athlete a long time ago. It's always fun playing for those types of guys. So it's been a pleasure to watch that for the last season.
And not just sitting by him, but sitting by our opponent.
Does he ask a lot of questions, Paul Allen?
Yeah, sure.
About business.
It's actually a really great time to experience kind of our product in terms of what we're trying to pull off from a fan experience perspective and what's going on in the arena. And it's a great, you know, time for me to catch him up on things where I need his input and advice on. So it works out great.
So is it better if we're winning the game to get something pushed through? Or
everything is better when you're winning. Yeah.
Tell a story quickly about there was a game mid-season or toward the end of the season where during a timeout, Paul got the dry erase board, and he was writing during the timeout. He's drawing up plays.
Yeah.
What was he actually doing?
Well, I explained what he was doing because everyone was asking me if he was drawing up plays during the game, and I was like, no, he wasn't drawing up plays. He was helping. We were sketching out some concepts as it relates to some T-shirts that he had an idea on that we wanted to design to, you know, be able to sell in our team store. Where we did those caricature shirts of, you know, LaMarcus and Damian. And so he was explaining it to me, and I wasn't grasping it. Sometimes I don't. Maybe I'm not that smart. But he said, he said to Neil, grab me a piece of paper. So Neil grabbed the closest thing to him, and he gave it to me and sketched it out, and I took it, and the rest is history. But he wasn't drawing up plays during the game.
On TV, it was great.
Yeah.
Oh, Paul's got a play. It's on the top.
This is Paul's inbounds play.
Yeah.
But cool
some
that he's
questions about that.
But cool that he's that proactive and that involved. And in things as you know, I would think some owners would see as kind of small things like T-shirts. But
yeah,
he loves that stuff.
He definitely does. If I could capture it, it's all about fan experience. And you know, he comments to me all the time. I'm like, man, look how loud our fans are, and it's so good to win a playoff game in front of them. They deserve it. They've been there all year, and it's you know, he's focused on how can we make sure the experience for games is top notch.
Yeah, the Seahawks came down. Pete, the general manager,
yeah.
That must have been a good experience for them to see the Blazer fans.
Yeah, they were amazing. Obviously, they have got a great environment there as well, but they were blown away by the environment we had here, and then we had Russell Wilson.
Yeah.
We had a lot of people coming
Chris, thanks for the update. We'll have you back in soon. Maybe if there's some need for some eventful news or something, we'll have you back on and you can update us.
Well, that'll be good. I was thinking it was a fishing show I thought I was in the wrong place.
You're in the Northwest now, and you said you've been skunked the last few times you've been out. So
I'm 0-3.
I will change that.
All right.
I will make sure we'll change that.
Amen.
We'll get you some salmon.
Sounds good.
All right. Thanks, Chris.
Thank you.
Blazers President Chris McGowan, our guest here on Trailblazers Courtside. We'll take a break.